we continue our conversation on the Best Managed Fund of the Year Awards of the CFA Society Philippines. We're now joined by Mark Ilao, Committee Chairman of the award-giving body. What is the CFA Society's goal in recognizing best managed funds in the Philippines? What's the objective?
Yeah, actually, there are two main objectives. One is to raise awareness among retail investors in terms of the options or the kind of funds that they can actually put their money into. The second actually is to promote the value of stewardship and fiduciary among fund managers in the country. And actually, part of that is also to promote the awareness on the CFA Institute Asset Manager Code.
Okay. I'm just curious about how the society identifies the best managed funds. Like, I would think, you know, or normally people would think that the way to look for the best managed fund is just to look at their performance, like which fund performed the best. But I don't think that is all there is to it. So maybe you could explain to us what you look for or what you look at to determine whether a fund is well managed.
Right. I think what you said is key to the matter. What should be the best fund? And the way we did it is, like I said, we want to raise awareness among retail investors while trying to promote fiduciary duty among fund managers. So what we did was to try to put forth a balance between risk and return, because ultimately when investors are putting their money in funds, their expectation is actually to grow their money, but not at the expense of actually taking on excessive risk. So for the past 9 years, the methodology that the CFA Society Philippines has actually used is what we call the risk-adjusted returns to determine the funds, more particularly what we call Sortino ratio. What this methodology does is it tries to take into account the negative volatility or negative returns of a fund, because behaviorally, that's what investors don't like. Normally, when you put your money in a fund, you expect that there's volatility. But if it's going up, that's highly acceptable. But if it's going down, that's not what you want, right? So what the Sortino ratio does is it actually penalizes funds that exhibit negative returns over a period of time. And then we take into account their returns. So again, it's a balance between the risk and return of the fund. So those funds who actually exhibited the best or highest risk-adjusted returns over a 3-year and 5-year period would be the awardees. And for this year, as I mentioned, we included passively managed funds, equity index funds. For that one, the methodology is actually to determine which fund exhibited the lowest tracking error. Because for a passively managed fund, your objective is to follow your index as closely as possible, and your tracking error or how the returns of the fund behave versus that benchmark would be the best way to determine if it's the best managed fund.
So you know, it sounds so technical, no, Sortino ratio, but maybe you could provide us a concrete example of a risk-taking behavior by a fund manager that, you know, if he does something right, then he will be rewarded. But if he made a wrong bet doing that thing, then, you know, his fund would actually, you know, lead to huge losses for the fund, for of course, the fund owners or the clients.
Right. So maybe, for example, you have Fund A and Fund B. Fund A gave you a return of 10%, while Fund B gave you a return of 8%. If you just take a look at the headline figures, you'd say that, hey, Fund A definitely performed better, right? But if we start introducing the risk level of these funds, and let's say Fund A exhibited a negative returns on average, the downside deviation is, let's say, 5%, while the other, Fund B, is only 3%. So if you now do the ratio, the Fund A that gave you 10% return, but on average was giving you 5% negative returns, it's actually 1:2, right? So for every return that it gave you, there's a commensurate risk that you would have gotten, which is a negative 5% along the way. But for the other fund, It gave you 8%, but the negative returns that you would have seen over a period of time is just maximum of 3%. So in that sense, Fund B is actually more efficient in terms
superior.
of generating returns versus the risk that it tries to take. And that's what we're trying to identify here when we're managing, when we're looking for the best managed funds award. Again, it's not just the ones with the highest returns, but the ones with the highest risk-adjusted returns, because ultimately, investors wouldn't like taking excessive risk for the returns that they will get.
So you don't only measure the performance at one period in time, like you measure it throughout the 3-year period, the 5-year period. Like if, for example, there were some periods where the fund fell by, as you said, 5% versus another fund who, you know, at one point in time would lose only 3%, then the fund with a lower loss during that time frame would be judged better.
Yep. And the time frame really matters a lot, because most of the time when investors actually do their fund selection activity, they just tend to look at 1-year track record. You know, what's the hot fund this year over a short period of time? And what we want to actually promote is long-term investing or long-term investment horizon. That's why you take a look at the fund over a long period of time. 5 years is there, but we also take into account 3 years. The rationale for that is actually to account for any potential changes in terms of the strategy or the fund manager. So at least the 3-year track record will bear any adjustments already. But the 5-year track record, which we also takes into account, will actually be the longer track record of the fund.
Yeah. So, you know, we're noticing more Filipinos now gaining interest in investing. Why do you think they should consider investing in funds? I mean, what are the benefits of investing in funds versus, say, going straight to, say, straight equities, straight bonds, or, you know, investing overseas, which, of course, they could also do by themselves?
Yeah. One is affordability compared to other asset classes where you can access them directly. Funds, normally, it will take a small amount of money, 1,000 or even as low as 50 pesos for some platforms. The other is the convenience, because you're tapping into the expertise of fund managers, people who are supposed to do the investing for you on a day-to-day basis. The third one is the ability to actually diversify right away. With funds, you're buying into a basket of different securities. So you don't need to worry about actually having a or taking on a very risky position in one or just two investment vehicles. And I think the last one is actually the ability to tap into other markets. That's what other funds have been doing today. For the longest time, Philippine investors can only access local investments, but as we know, sometimes local investments won't give you the kind of returns that you expect. And that's why funds are there to give you access to, let's say, global markets or funds that actually give out dividends on a regular basis. So really, I think funds have made investing much, much easier for a lot of investors.
Okay, so with that, thank you very much, Mark, for your thoughts on the topic. And, good luck to CFA Philippines, doing this endeavor. And I hope you will have many, many more years and more participants in this fund award.
Thank you, Ms. April. Happy to be here.
Okay, thank you so much. Have a good day.